see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds.
About a year ago, when we really knew that this dream was really going to come to life, we started looking for our guest speaker, for our featured speaker. We had this idea that if we could get a Vietnam era Congressional Medal of Honor winner, that was the ticket. After a long, extensive search, we found one. We wrote the letter, we asked the question. We realized there would be expenses to pay. But when we got the response, the expenses wasn't the only thing. There was an honorary $5,000 initiation or a speaker's fee. Now maybe that's the way things done, I don't know, but it didn't seem right to me. When I brought it back to the committee, it didn't seem right to the committee either, so that dream was dead. And so many times in life, you go looking for a gem. The whole time you're walking right over a diamond. Our featured speaker has been among us all this time. He's been a longtime resident of the Boonville area. He's been a part of many, many community affairs and events. He attended Springfield College up until 1964, where upon graduating, he took an immediate commission in the United States Marine Corps. Served 3 years active duty, one of which as a platoon leader for B Company, 1st Battalion, 3rd Marines in Vietnam from November of 65 to September of 1966. He led his troops that year in all phases of combat actions in Vietnam, one of which he was awarded a Bronze Star and a Purple Heart during Operation Orange when he refused medical evacuation after being wounded until his troops were secure. After active duty, he went on to spend 24 more years as a distinguished career in the Marine Corps Reserves and rose to the rank of full colonel before retiring. He was a founding member in the Vietnam Vets get-together and one of only two that is here today that have been to all 25, and he is the undisputed leader of that event. He taught 19 years at SUNY State College as a professor of marketing. 25 years ago, he started the Boonville Lodging Kit Company, which has been a source of local employment for many people in this rural area. He recently expanded that business to New Smyrna Beach, where he lives now with his wife, Cheryl. They come back on numerous occasions to visit with friends and family members, which include his mother, their two sons, who I might also add served distinguished careers as Marine Corps officers, and their four lovely grandchildren. It is truly my privilege and honor to introduce to you Colonel Kenneth Martin.
Thank you, Ken. Good evening, fellow citizens. Good evening, fellow veterans, and especially good evening to our beloved Gold Star mothers. They are the first people I want to address tonight. As Ken just said, we have two sons. They spent 7 years on active duty in the Marine Corps. Marine Corps courses, there's going to be a fight, they're going to be involved. And we often worried about them, as all parents do. We used to think every now and then and talk about what if they were killed in action. We didn't talk very long. We couldn't. We just couldn't imagine that. We do not know the depth of the sorrow that our Gold Star mothers went through. And I'd like to offer the following words to console our Gold Star mothers. It's this: for every tear you shed, there are 10 other tears shed by the comrades who were there with your sons. For every memory you had over the years of your sons, there were 10 other comrades who were remembering your sons. You have to understand that when you're in combat, the brotherhood, the camaraderie you have is closer and tighter than anybody can ever imagine. You have to go through it to understand what I'm saying. Those who have know what I'm saying. 49 years now, every day of my life, I've thought of those people who are left behind. The kind Lord is good enough to me and permits me some time. The second last thought I'll have on this earth will be of your sons and their comrades. I want to tell a couple stories about some of the men on the wall behind us. I know a number of them, I'm going to tell you the stories of four of them. Two of the stories are going to take me rather short. The other one's going to take some length to explain. The first person I want to talk about is PFC Richard Wright. Richard Wright was from Kansas. He was a farmer. He was a member of my platoon. In early April of 1966, we were going to go on an operation. The operation was going to be in Happy Valley. We'd been in Happy Valley before, and we, of course, as you can well imagine, it wasn't very happy at all. We had a great deal of fear in us. We had a lot of trepidation. Wright was on light duty. He did not have to go on this operation. He had immersion foot. Those people there used to be called trench foot in World War I. His feet were full of scabs and sores. His ankles up and down his shins. He did not have to go. He came to me and said, "Lieutenant, I want to go." I said, "You don't have to go." He said, "I want to go." "Okay, you're going to go." The next day, we took off. Within 3 hours, he was killed 8 feet in front of me. One of the obligations of an officer is to write home to the next of kin, which I did. 3 weeks after I wrote this, as you can well imagine, a very difficult letter to write, I received a box. It's from his teenage sister. The box was full of brownies and chocolate chip cookies. With a note, she said, "Our family is devastated, but I want to do something for the people who my brother served with and who loved." The next person I want to talk about is Lance Corporal Ralph Williams. Williams was a black Marine from the south side of Chicago. He's a very quiet and reserved young man. On Okinawa, where we did 3 weeks training before I went to Vietnam, he had told his best friend that he was not going to come back. There are two things I remember about Wright. The first thing was that he was one of two men of 42 in my platoon who didn't smoke. Everybody in those days, you go to combat, you're either smoking cigarettes or chewing tobacco. He did not. As I said, he was a very quiet and reserved young man. He also was very religious. Wherever he went, he had a Bible. We'd take a break, he'd be sitting on the deck, he'd be reading his Bible. He too was killed. And both Wright and Williams, we found in Panel 6 East, line 79. The next person, it's going to take a little bit longer to explain. His name is Corporal Larry Fleming. Corporal Fleming was from South Carolina. He was the most ferocious and fiercest Marine I ever served with. He was an incredible athlete. He was All-State in South Carolina as a little linebacker. He got a full scholarship to college to play football. He was also an accomplished boxer. He won the Golden State, the Golden Gloves competition as a heavyweight in the state of South Carolina in high school. He continued to box in the Marine Corps, where he finished third in the All-Marine Heavyweight Division. You got to understand, the Marine Corps also produced two world champions in the last 40 years. He was an incredible athlete. He went to school, he dropped out. One day, as we were training at Camp Pendleton, I said, "Corporal, why don't you become an officer, stay in school?" And a big piece of chewing tobacco, and looked at me and said, "Lieutenant, I ain't no college boy." And he wasn't no college boy. He was born to be a Marine Corps, a non-commissioned officer. In January of 1966, we were on an operation, Operation Mallard. And all of a sudden, my platoon was going to a ville. We're in this ville, a village. It was about 50 huts, a lot of vegetation. You gotta understand, we had never been there before. Things were all right, then all of a sudden, we started receiving sniper fire. One of the obligations always for an officer is to have control of things. So we had a very hasty 360 where we tried to tie in on my three squads, and anybody in front of us was probably bad. Anybody behind us was our own people. I had to get my squad leaders up. One of my squad leaders was Corporal Fleming. Came up and I said, "Listen, here's what I want, the machine guns, here's what I want this, here's what I want that." And all of a sudden, there's a lot of automatic fire from where Corporal Fleming's squad was. He got up. His last words to me were these: "This is my fight." And he ran off, jumped in a trench line. He was killed. About two or three minutes later, I got there. He was shot through the heart. He probably had 30 seconds before he was dead. 14 years ago, I was working here in Boonville, and I was going to go on a long sales trip. Actually, one of the places was South Carolina. I went to a place called Spartanburg, which is in the western part of the state, called in a customer. And Corporal Fleming was from Piedmont, South Carolina, which was about 30 minutes from where I was. I got to Piedmont, South Carolina. It's the same size as Boonville. There was a police officer in the car. I went up to him and explained to him what I was there for. He said, "I can't help you, sir, but why don't you go try the library two blocks down?" I went to the library. Little old gray-haired lady, librarian, said to me, "I think he's buried in the Baptist cemetery." And I said, "Okay, where is it?" So I went to the Baptist church about a mile out of town. It's a very big church, and on each side of the church was a cemetery. I went to the left side, I went through the whole thing, I could not find it. I went to the right side, and the first gravestone I came to, the first plot I came to, was Corporal Fleming's. I brought some flowers, and I was standing there and just paying my respects and saying a couple of prayers. And a lady came up to me, she saw what I was doing, and we started talking. And then she said this to me, she said, "Do you know that he was the only child?" I said, "No." You gotta understand, that set me back a little further. She also said this. She said, when his mother learned of the death of Larry, she said her life was essentially over. And then she said she died maybe 2 years after that. And she told me that the members of the congregation, they all said, "She died of a broken heart." That's what she told me. And I think she probably did. The last person I want to talk to about is a dear friend of mine called Captain Henry Kolakowski. I returned from Vietnam in September of 1966. I had orders to Marine Corps Base H&S Company. I reported in there. I became the executive officer. Captain Kolakowski was the commanding officer. He was a brilliant officer. He was a kind officer. He took care of his troops. He had not been to Vietnam, so all he wanted to do for me, every time we talked, hey, what's this? What's this? What can I do? He picked my brains as much as he can. As I said, he was a career officer. He was a graduate of the Naval Academy in Annapolis. But that's all we did. We talked all the time just about what went on. My wife and I became very good friends with Hank and his wife, Linda. We went over to their house a number of times, played cards with them. My wife and I were childless, we were newlyweds. They had had a new baby, a 6-month-old baby named Stephen. The baby would start crying, Linda would go in and feed the baby. Things, again, that my wife and I didn't know yet. We were very, very close. 4 months after that, I arrived and worked as his executive officer. I had orders to the 27th Regiment. I became a company commander there. After 7 months, I was released from active duty in September of 67, at which time my wife and I moved to San Diego. We're in San Diego pursuing careers. I was working, she was working, bought a house. We're getting on with our lives. We hadn't really kept in touch with the Kolakowskis. One Friday afternoon, I came home from work before my wife did it, when I got the mail. And inside the mailbox was a couple advertising circulars, some bills, and a little card, a little note, a little envelope just addressed to us, a small envelope, the size of something like this. And I thought it was an invitation to a party. It wasn't. There was no return address. It was from Linda Kolakowski. This is the letter she sent me. She sent us. I've kept this for many years. I've shared it with some people. I'll share it with you, and I hope I don't take anybody's name in vain. Again, remember, I did not know anything. I opened this thing, I read it, and it reads, "Dear Cheryl and Ken, it's a very difficult task I now have of writing to friends to tell you that my dear Hank was killed in action on 15 June. Steve, the baby," and now she writes, "the expected baby," in parentheses, she puts R&R. Do you understand? They had R&R, at which time they conceived a child that never saw his father, a father that never saw that child. She then continues to say where she's going to be living and concludes this note, "Only time will help to remedy the complete grief I feel for myself and my children. Sincerely, Linda." What sacrifices and what sadness. What character is told by the wall behind me. There's no selfish me, me, me on that wall. All of them are heroes, and I want everybody here to understand that they represent the best of my generation. They gave their all. They died for their country. They died for their comrades. They died for you and me. I want to talk briefly about politics now and then. I want all veterans here to raise your hands, please. Any veteran, raise your hand. You can put them down. Now, the same vets that have raised their hands, I want to find out how many of you had brothers or sisters, children, grandchildren, nephews and nieces that have worn a uniform. Raise your hands as well. You see the point that I'm going to make. The same people are making the same sacrifices that have been taking place for the last 50 years. And I'm tired of it. Part of the casualties coming from the barrios, the farms, the projects, the small towns, and the Native American reservations. Here's what I want. I want the Bushes, I want the Clintons, I want the Obamas, I want the members of Congress, I want their children, and I want the children of the talking heads on radio and television from both the left and right. I want their kids to drag their best friend in a poncho to a waiting helicopter and hope that they get home and to a battalion aid station and save their lives. The same people are paying the same price. It's time to stop that. I hear the words, and you've heard the words lately, boots on the ground, used so frivolously by politicians and newscasters. Put their kids in those boots. See how cavalier they are when they say put boots on the ground. More people in this country have to have skin in the game than not. And if they did, perhaps we'd have less wars and we'd have more successful outcomes to them. Our war was over for the Vietnam veterans here in the early 1970s. We all went about our business, finding a career, starting a family, things like that. I've always done a lot of traveling. Whenever I've traveled, I've always worn something that identifies me as a Marine and or a Vietnam veteran. So this happened in the late 70s. I can't give you a date. Late 70s, a strange thing happened to me. I'm walking through the O'Hare Airport. I've got my Marine cap on, whatever it is. I see a guy come with a black leather vest with all his patches on. He sees me. I see him. And he says, "Hey, were you in Vietnam?" I said, "Yes, I was." And I said, "Well, some of these things where, hey, who were you with? When were you there?" That kind of thing. Then he took his hand out and gave it to me. And he said a very strange thing to me. You know what he said? We shook hands and he said to me, this is in the late 70s, "Welcome home, brother." Well, this started happening more and more. And again, I can't give you a date. Every Vietnam veteran here knows what I'm talking about. About 3 or 4 years after this first time it happened again at another airport. So I'm sitting in a bar, and I think, and it just happened again. I said, "Welcome home, brother." Then it came to me, the deeper meaning behind it. Welcome home, brother. We welcomed ourselves home because this country did not. I know two soldiers. I know one of them here and one of them down in Florida. They're good friends of mine. They don't tell lies. They both tell a similar story. Late 60s, early 70s, they landed in Travis Air Force Base. That's where they would be processed out and given orders or admin taking place. And both these soldiers told me this. They said a non-commissioned officer came up to them and said, "Listen, son, I recommend that you don't wear your uniform when you go home." Can you imagine that? Imagine that. I also have heard stories, and I have a story from one of the guys who rode in just the other day on a bike. He's a very good friend of mine. People being spat at in the uniform when they came home from Vietnam. Never happened to me. The guy who told me this said it happened to him, and I believe it. I have this to say, and I could say a lot more than this, to the people who in this country created that atmosphere. I say shame on you. I'm going to say it one more time. Shame on you. So, my fellow Vietnam veterans, we came home sometimes to hostility, but more importantly, we came home to indifference. Nobody really cared. Because of that, because of the bloody war that we fought in, I think this, and I am sure of this, we are the tightest band of veterans that we've seen in 100 years. The Vietnam veteran is different. I know the World War II veterans. My father was one, like most of your fathers and uncles were. They were the greatest generation. I know the Korean guys. We put on 2 parties for them here. Just a year ago, I put one on in New Smyrna Beach. I know the Korean guys. I certainly know the Iraqi and Afghani guys. But nobody went through what we went through. We are incredibly tight. I felt that the other night when the bikes came in. How many bike riders were here, took the bike ride in? We had 200, 250 bikes came in, and I felt the spirit of the Vietnam veteran as they rode by me. So I tell this to my Vietnam veterans that are here tonight, be proud, stand tall. And I say this to you, I love you, and I will go anywhere with you, and that's a fact. In conclusion, I want to tell you, I want to confess to you, that I am a believer. I'm not in any particular religion. I'm not in any organized religion. I believe in our good Lord. In Norse mythology, there was a place called Valhalla. Valhalla was a castle way up in the sky somewhere. It's where the Nordic warriors who were slain in battle went to. May I, my kind Lord, carry me to that place. May I knock on that gate. May the gate open. May I see a thousand campfires in front of me. May one of those campfires, a bunch of guys get up, hey, Lieutenant, over here. May I be transported over there. May I go down there. May they say to me, sit down. Sit down in front of the fire. And at that time, may a gunnery sergeant come in with a case of sea rations, slip the jacket off of it. Oh, but here's your chow, guys. And may we then trade ham and limas or turkey loaf. May we then change. Trade peaches for pound cake. May we then take out that little tin cup, put a heat tab underneath it, pour water in it, make our coffee again. At this time, put a little Jack Daniels in it. May we then get up and toast each other. May we embrace one another. And may we be together again. May we finally be together again. And may our kind Lord continue to bless our country. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
So when you ask them, how much should we give?